All right, now we're going to look at the large-scale organization of the brain in terms of so-called gross anatomy. And if you've seen a real brain, as I have in your hands, it's kind of gross. It's very slimy. And anyway, let's not go there. So we're now going to look at first the kind of overall organization of the brain, the kind of largest scale parts of it. As we've been talking about several times, the most important part of the brain is the cerebral cortex, also known as the neocortex. That's where all the kind of uniquely human cognition takes place, and is the area that's kind of uniquely enlarged in mammals and especially primates, etc. That's interconnected with the thalamus, which is known as sort of the gateway to the cortex, and it really is impossible in people and primates and other mammals to think about the thalamus independent of the cortex. It's really the thalamocortical system. They're totally interconnected. They don't operate independently. And then in that context, the basal ganglia, which is again thought of this separate kind of system, and it does have an origin kind of earlier on in evolution, is intimately in people and other primates, intimately interconnected with the frontal cortex. And so you really can't think about what the frontal cortex does independent of what the basal ganglia is doing. And to reinforce the previous point, the basal ganglia is also directly interconnected with the thalamus. And so really, there's this kind of sort of cortical thalamic and basal ganglia system, corticostriatal. This is another name for the input area of the basal ganglia. Those are all kind of one big system. You have also the hippocampus, which is also known as archicortex, protocortex. It's kind of an early evolving part of the cortex, kind of an initial plan for how the cortex then developed later. And as we've talked about, it's very important for episodic memory. And we'll talk a lot about that in the memory chapter. So it's also kind of really part of cortex. We don't really think of it as separate from cortex. In many ways, it's actually the top of the cortex. And so there's an interesting kind of interconnected synthetic kind of relationship among all these areas, even though they're anatomically separable and do have these evolutionary kind of trajectories in the current system. They're very much integrated. And along those lines, the amygdala is really important for emotion. It's fully interconnected with the basal ganglia. Many people think of it really as kind of part of the basal ganglia. Part of it is actually directly contiguous with the basal ganglia. And it's really important for all the things that the basal ganglia does. And then you have kind of these more brainstem areas. And there, I think you can reasonably draw a kind of line and say that there's all these areas that are really part of the cortex. And then you have these much more ancient basic systems, hypothalamus, the pons, the medulla oblongata, and yes, to a certain extent, the cerebellum. And these serve much more basic kind of survival type of functions, and in particular, the medulla oblongata, which is the strangest named brain area, is really important for basic kind of breathing and autonomic functions and just kind of like keeping you alive. And the pons and the cerebellum are really one system, and that's really important for doing kind of motor control and refining your ability to kind of act in the world. It really is a kind of separate subbrain there. It's like a module. It turns out that if you lose your cerebellum later in life, you really don't have that much of a significant effect. So it's actually kind of a learning system training up the cortex to be able to do a lot of motor control stuff. Of course, if you want to learn something new later in life, it also is important for that. Okay, so what are these systems doing? Well, we think about the cortex as this very high level kind of detector system, developing these internal representations that are much more abstract and have these high level concepts. And so that's kind of the kind of idea world, the notion of kind of abstract representations and coding of the world. But the basal ganglia in that context is kind of the hard-headed decision-making, in many ways, more of the kind of executive decision-maker relative to the cortex. And so it's integrating a lot of information about the pros and cons, the track record, the history of action and outcomes, and deciding at any moment, like, what is it that we should be doing? And so the basal ganglia has these special circuits that we'll see that really make these judgments about, should I do it or not? It's always saying, should I do it or not? And we think about these as the go pathway and the no-go pathway. And it's really just deciding between those two basic existential kind of questions, do it or not. The thalamus is also very important for relaying kind of sensory information into the cortex, and also driving kind of overall activity levels and arousal in the cortex. And so it does play a really important role kind of coordinating and supplying the cortex with fundamental kind of activity. And so it does have a slightly separable role in understanding how the sensory information gets into the cortex and this kind of modulation of arousal. But there's just tons of loops interconnecting every area of the thalamus with different areas of the cortex. So it's also very integral. The amygdala, as we've said a few times, I think, is very important for emotion. If you have damage to the amygdala, you do not have the same kind of normal fear of dangerous situations, and people with damage to the amygdala end up kind of burning themselves on stoves and, you know, getting run over by cars. I mean, it's like, yikes. You just have to have those basic kind of fearful reactions to dangerous situations. And that's what the amygdala is important for, but it's also important for positive emotional information. And so it actually, it's like a kind of 80-20 rule. It's about 80% negative emotional states and then about 20% positive emotional states if you sort of count the different neurons in the amygdala, which more or less maps onto regular life. You know, there's many ways in which people are dysfunctional and depressed, but only a few ways in which they're happy. It's a bad version of the Dostoevsky quote. And then the hypothalamus is really kind of this core control system along with the medulla oblongata. It's really like the most basic core system important for regulating wake, sleep, you know, eating, all kinds of basic genetically coded behaviors, and also plugs right into the hormonal system and this kind of fight versus flight behavior. So really kind of core low-level systems are coded up in the hypothalamus there. And it's important not to confuse the hypothalamus with the thalamus. Really, there's no connection there. I mean, anatomically, it's below the thalamus, but really, they're very, very different systems, nor is it part of the hippocampus, even though they start with the letter H. Okay, so it's really important to know kind of at this level the basic functionality of these different large-scale brain systems. In general, in this course and in science in general, we kind of really focus on these cortical systems. Again, this is where people live. It turns out, as we'll see in the next chapter, there's every reason to believe that we're only conscious of things that take place in the cortex. Cortex is the soul, the seat of the soul, the place where we're aware. It's what we think of as our self. And then all these other systems are kind of lower level systems helping out essentially that cortical system from that perspective. So hippocampus, amygdala, basal ganglia kind of all play important kind of supporting roles in interfacing with that neocortical system. And a lot of times in older literature, you'll see actually those brain systems, hippocampus, amygdala, basal ganglia, especially referred to as the limbic system, and this notion of kind of the more kind of emotional aspects of your brain. And certainly those are kind of core motivational kind of emotional aspects of your brain. I think the whole brain is really emotional and associated with those aspects of function. And there's lots of these other low-level systems, which, again, from this corticocentric perspective,